So students, we have been studying manners for the last few lectures, okay, and this is part of your unit 4. Now we have reached almost the last topic in your unit 4. So we are dealing with the security issues. We saw the security, different kind of security issues that arise in manners, the different types of attacks that are possible, okay. Then we saw also how the attacks are classified. The attacks are classified as passive attacks, active attacks, and we discussed that passive attacks are mostly attacks that are based on without disturbing the network. It's just like traffic monitoring or snooping. Those kind of attacks come under passive attacks, where the attacker is trying to steal the data without disturbing the network operations. And active attacks are those attacks wherein the normal functionality of the network is affected. Okay, so those are various kind of mostly attacks that are focused on routing, the routing tables, or some kind of malicious node that update the IP addresses so that the packets are not delivered or packets are dropped. Those kind of attacks come under active attacks. Most of them are based on changing, based on routing or denial of service attacks, okay, wherein the network connectivity is compromised. Again, then we discuss those different attacks in terms of the layers, at which layers those kind of attacks could happen, and we discuss each of these attacks in detail yesterday, wherein I explained you each of these attacks. But today we'll just look at some of the countermeasures that can be applied at some of the layers, okay, in order to prevent these attacks. And then we will go over to our new topic, that is your last topic of your syllabus. So these were the different attacks that we looked at yesterday. So now let's start with the what can be done to prevent these attacks. Okay, so at the different layers, some kind of security measures could be employed so that the attacks could be prevented or reduced. Maybe not completely eliminated, but maybe we can reduce the attacks or even prevent the attacks. Okay. At the data link layer, we can employ something known as a spread spectrum. Okay, so by spread spectrum, what we mean is normally when the transmission happens, the transmission happens over a narrow range of frequency, a narrow band of frequency. Okay, so in military and all, for secure communication, using some special kind of coding and all those things, they spread the frequency over a larger area. Okay, so the same data is transmitted over a larger area. Okay, so that is known as spread spectrum in simple words. Okay, we don't need to go into the details. And then we use something known as a directional antenna. Okay, the directional antenna will transmit it in the direction that the antenna is pointing. Okay, it sends the transmission in a particular direction. So instead of having an antenna which spreads the signal in all directions, okay, if the signal is spread in all directions, then in a manet the signal will come, manet nodes may not get the strong signal because the signal is getting spread in all directions, so the signal that they may receive is weak. So in order to prevent that, they use a directional antenna in order to send a focused transmission in a particular direction. Okay, so maybe we can use both of this together. Okay, so or separately depending on the application. Okay, so you spread the data, spread the signal, and then focus it in a particular direction instead of spreading it 360 degrees or transmitting it 360 degrees. Okay, at the network layer, you could use the security measures like authentication, and you could keep track of where the devices are moving. Okay, whichever devices are supposed to be part of the network. Then at the transport layer, you could use data transmission, data encryption techniques, okay, to secure and authenticate the end-to-end transmissions or end-to-end communication. And at the application layer, we could prevent all those Trojan horses, virus attacks by, okay, through code analysis. So you could do some code analysis, okay, and prevent this kind of attacks through malicious code. So basically, you could be asked in the exams one question. I've seen a question come on this. What are the security attack countermeasures at the different layers? Okay. Now in your textbook only, this is the table that has been given. So you will need to remember this countermeasures, okay, at the different protocol layers and write about this. Okay. So let's proceed to the last topic of your syllabus. Okay. So there is a special kind of MANET known as a vehicular ad hoc network. Okay. Since it starts with vehicles, it's instead of MANET, it is called as a VANET. So it is also a MANET, a special kind of a MANET. So only the difference is, in a MANET, mostly we were using mobile nodes. Okay, the mobile nodes were part of the network. The mobiles were the nodes. Here, in a VANET, the vehicles will be the nodes. Okay, the vehicles will act as ad hoc devices, and they will be forming a network with each other. Okay, so basically, VANET system examples could be your police vehicles, your fire engines, ambulances, etc. Okay, so such kind of networks could be within each other's range, within the city, for example. Okay, so within 100 to 300 meters range, they can communicate with each other. Okay, and such kind of nodes could also communicate with some roadside devices. Okay, so unlike MANETs, the nodes in a MANET can only communicate with other nodes in the MANET. Okay, but your vehicle, the nodes in a VANET, those vehicles could communicate with some other roadside devices. Okay, if there were some roadside devices, so depending on the size of the VANET, it could be some kilometers wide. Okay, so it could be, depending on the how many vehicles are included in the VANET, the size of the network could be quite a lot. Okay, some kilometers wide it could be. Then this kind of networks could be multi-hop networks. Okay, so basically they have all the characteristics of ad hoc networks and MANETs. Okay, except that they will be vehicles. The nodes in this case will be vehicles. Okay, and some of the issues that a MANET faces will be kind of solved in vehicles. Okay, for example, the battery power in a mobile, you know, the battery capacity is quite less in a mobile, but in a vehicle the battery capacity is not an issue. Okay, the battery is not an issue normally. Okay, it can get worn out, you may have to replace it every 3 or 5 years. Okay, but it's not an issue that it gets drained off like in a mobile. Okay, so that is not an issue. But there's another issue with regards to VANETs, that is, in a MANET, the mobile nodes do move around. Okay, but they do not move at a very high speed, meaning they can't travel very fast. But a vehicle, you know, the speed of a vehicle, it can move very fast. Okay, so it need not be in a particular area for too much time. It can be moving at quite a speed. So whenever you're designing a VANET, okay, you need to take into consideration that a vehicle can move quite fast. So the speed of the vehicle needs to be taken into consideration while designing a VANET. So that is one of the differences between a VANET and a MANET. Okay, so we'll discuss some of the differences between these two at the end of this topic. Okay, so basically, when you're writing for your exams, if you're asked to write a short note on VANETs, you will need to tell that it's a special kind of a MANET, and almost all the characteristics of a MANET are part of your VANET, except that the battery is not much of an issue. Okay, so the battery is not much of an issue in a vanet, because the batteries in a vehicle don't get discharged so easily. Okay, but another issue occurs in vanets that does not occur in vanets. That is, vanets, the vehicles can move around quite fast. Okay, so therefore that needs to be taken into consideration while designing a vanet network. Okay, so let's see how they can be used. So for example, you are having a network of vanet, okay, where the vehicles are connected through a vanet. Okay, then what could happen is, if some accident has occurred in the city, okay, the one thing that you need to before I tell you the use, you need to know that the vanet can the network can be formed only along the roads. Okay, so typically your vanet will be network will be having the topology of your roads, the city roads. Okay, they cannot because your vehicles can mostly, you can assume that they are on the roads only. Okay, you are driving them only on the roads, so your vanet topology will be restricted to the roads of your city. So how it can be used is, the vanets could communicate with each other to exchange information, like so whatever is the vehicles may notice. For example, one vehicle has noticed that there is a accident that has occurred. Okay, then it may inform the other nodes in the vanet that some accident has occurred in that route. Okay, or it could give some other kind of information which it can find on the route, like petrol stations, malls. Okay, or it could help to display the maps. Then drivers could use voice services, see the news, do some video conferencing, enjoy some entertainment, or exchange some information. Okay, so the vanets could, so typically you can assume that the distance between the nodes will be between 100 to 300 meters. Okay, so they did not exchange only the data with the other vehicles, they could also exchange data with some stationary devices that are collecting information or exchanging information. Okay, so let's just look at some of the differences that we can find in between a manet and a vanet. So basically, a manet is collection of mobile nodes that can communicate with each other without having any infrastructure. Okay, so this is a manet. Vanet is, it's again a special kind of a manet. Okay, here the nodes are on the move, and also they are similar, like I told you, to manets. So therefore they are ad hoc. Okay, and they can communicate with other vehicles that are part of the vanet, as well as standalone roadside units. So these are those other devices that I was referring to. So if there are any devices that are there on the road, then they could also communicate with those kind of devices to exchange any kind of information. Okay, then in a manet, the movement of nodes is more random. Okay, topology is more dynamic. But in a vanet, the topology is more or less, like I told you, it is constrained to the roads. So the roads in your city, so your nodes will move only along the roads. Then in a manet, you can't expect very fast changes compared to a vanet. Okay, this comparison we are doing with respect to a vanet. But in a vanet, the nodes can change, the topology can change quite fast because of the speed of the vehicle. Then power is a constraint in manet because of the battery, the capacity of the mobile battery. But in a vanet, the battery of the vehicle is not an issue. So therefore, the vanet can be powered up more than compared to a node in the manet. Okay. Then the speed is not an issue. The movement of the node is not an issue for vanet design. Okay, you may not consider it, but in a vanet, the speed of the vehicle should be considered while designing a vanet. Okay, how fast the node can move around the city. So basically, these are the major differences between a mannet and a vanet. So with this small topic, actually, we come to the end of our topic for this mobile computing. So if you are having any doubts, you can let me know. Okay, this concludes your syllabus. So are you having any doubt with this topic that we have discussed today? Any questions?